Wonderful, wonderful. Inviting one and all to close their eyes. And just breathe in and out easily and effortlessly. Easy breathing. Relaxing the body. Now envision a waterfall of light pouring from heaven. A waterfall of light pouring from heaven into this very room. That light is glistening. White light with specks of gold sparkles. And just bathe and saturate yourself in this golden white light pouring from heaven into unity, into this very building. And that light is 10,000 suns, the brightness of. Therefore, please keep your eyes closed. A waterfall of healing, cleansing, purifying, golden white light pouring into the Unity Building. Saturating this room. Continuing down through the floors into Mother Earth. This white, golden light pouring from heaven into the Unity Building. Right now we are at the center of this planet, this very building. As this white, healing, cleansing, purifying light pours into unity. It's pouring down vertically. But now picture yourself with arms outstretched that you may hold a hand or touch the person next to you. Imagine we are all touching. You do not have to move. Just picture everyone touching as this golden, white, healing, cleansing, purifying light fills the Unity Building and structure. The light of 10,000 suns. So just bask in that. Bask and bathe in that. The physical body that all stress and strain and anxiety leaves the physical frame. As you bathe in the etheric body, the health body, pain-free, no aches or pains, all the muscles and tissues and blood and arteries and capillaries and blood, organ systems are all functioning 100% plus, healing the DNA and RNA. This white light with gold sparks, healing, cleansing, purifying. And as it penetrates all seven layers, all seven bodies, physical, etheric, the mental, the spiritual bodies. Healing is occurring right here. Now visualize the light go going in the circle around the Unity building. It is literally circling the Unity facility, where we are at the center of the planet. This healing, cleansing, purifying light of 10,000 suns. Healing everything in this path, as above, so below. And the light is circling so fast that the many bodies in this room become one at the center as Source. So Source is in the midst of this room as this healing, cleansing, purifying light circles the Unity building. And because Source so loves his creation, humanity, we're going to share this light. Please bring this light to your heart and pulse it out. Literally push it out beyond the structure of the Unity building. Push the light through. The 10,000 suns, push it through to the city of Myrtle Beach, to the state of South Carolina. Push it north, south, east, and west, in every direction, that it may touch every continent on the planet. North America, South America, Europe, Africa, Asia, Antarctica, that healing, cleansing, purifying, golden white light is circling the planet Earth. With Source at the center of this structure, we share that light of 10,000 suns. Healing has occurred in every direction. Healing all that walk on the lands of planet Earth. Healing all that in the waters on planet Earth. And now it's almost like an EMP pulse. That light goes out into the atmosphere and to space. That healing, cleansing, purifying white light with gold sparkles. Feel as if you've experienced the Christ consciousness for 1 or 2 seconds with this light. Continue to saturate and penetrate and infiltrate everything and everyone on this planet as it continues to go out. The waterfall of light is still flowing. We are still in the flow. But with all good things, on this planet, they change or come to an end. So now the waterfall of light in this room is decreasing from 10,000 suns to 5,000. decreasing now to 2,000 sons. Decreasing now to 1,000 sons. Decreasing to 500. The waterfall of light turns out. And now, the light from space and the atmosphere starts to contract and come back in. Going out from one continent to the next, to the next, to the next, until we're back in the state of South Carolina, and we are now back in this room. That energy is still ongoing. So now Source, that was sitting in the midst of us, the one now goes back to the many bodies that are sitting in the chairs in this room. And as we drop the hands and let go of each other, coming back to yourselves, coming back to your individual spaces, breathing easily and effortlessly. In and out. In and out. Coming back to the room. And just know that you can have access to that waterfall of light at any time. But you must share it with humanity. Just take one last healing, cleansing breath, and you may open your eyes.
Well, I hope everybody was able to hear that.
We got it. We got it. We got it. We got it.
Okay.
Wonderful.
So, my topic today, Eyes on the Prize, is kind of a continuation of the children's message. We're going to talk about the prize and the process of how to get there. And I'm going to go about it by using the quote with four lines, and each of those lines starts with the letter F. So that's how we're going to do it. And, you know, we're here as human beings having this spiritual experience, but I want to talk about the process of being on this planet in these bodies. Now, I believe in reincarnation. You don't have to, so that doesn't matter. So it's like you're dying to get back here, be reborn. So we take on another body. We come here to learn lessons, maybe to fulfill unfinished business or to continue with soul contracts. Whatever the reason, we're back again. And know that nothing is ever lost, even though we don't remember. So, the most asked question on the planet, regardless of where you live, your religion, your background, whatever, is who am I? Where do I come from? Where am I going? Who question on the planet. And the thing of it is, there's a tendency when things are not exactly going right in your life, the tendency is to ask why. Why me? And for me, asking why means victim. Don't ask why. I think the question should be what and how. So the what is, it all starts with BS. Belief system. Belief system, I got that from Floyd. BS, belief system. Belief system which turn into thoughts. So, kind of touched on this with the children's message. So, yeah, I mean, you bring that with you because you're a consciousness already when you take on another body. So you're bringing those beliefs back here with you. So what are your beliefs that become your thoughts? So what are you thinking? It's not why. What are you thinking? And then the thoughts become words. Thinking, thinking. Too much chatter going on up there in the mind. Thinking. The thoughts become words. So what are you saying to yourself? Is it self-sabotage, or are you lifting yourself up? Or are you critical, always talking about others? I mean, we're New Thought people. We don't do that, right? And then the words turn into action. Now, action for me means doing. Doing with the body. What are your hands doing? What are you doing with your feet? Where are your feet taking you on a daily basis? Action with the body. Hands, feet, eyes, ears, doing. Or action. So thought, words, and deeds eventually turn into habits. And the habits start as early as Ayana's age. And then those habits turn into your values. What do you value? Things or people or family. And those values eventually become your destiny. Now, the thing about children that I love is that they're innocent. And I want to tell you a story about a couple that had two children. The oldest was a girl, 5 or 6 years old. At least she was old enough that she can walk and talk, you know, do complete sentences and have some little discernment. And she kept asking the parents that she wanted to be alone in the room with the baby, who was only 2 or 3 months old. And they kind of dismissed it. But the child was insistent. She wanted to be alone in the room with her sister. So they finally acquiesced and allowed her to do that. But they put a baby monitor in the room so they could hear what was going on. I'm not sure it was cameras in those days, but that's the way the story goes. So what they heard was astonishing. And the first time I heard the story, I was kind of brought to tears. So the 5-year-old leaned over and asked the child, "Please tell me about God. I'm starting to forget." And I said, "Wow, that was that's divine for me." So that's the innocence of the children. They still have that connection. You know, we know there's a connection that between human beings and God. So that story just made it real. Even more real for me. So let's get going on. So I'm going to recommend, this is just a recommendation of some ways to get to the prize through these 4 phrases or sentences that start with the letter F. So let's get started. First, we're going to follow the master. Who is the master? It can be a guru, a teacher, prodigy, an expert,
conscience. I don't hear people say that anymore. I don't know what's going on, but I don't. So for us in New Thought, it is about the Christ consciousness. Nothing on the outside. Follow the master. So the master is personal, up to you, whoever it is that you want to follow. And so in the end, I think the master is the heart or love. I know it's kind of the most misused or abused word around, but it really is love. So instead of WWJD, it's WWLD. What would love do under all circumstances in every situation that comes up? So when life throws you that lemon, what are you going to do? It's always put God first. That's the love. Maybe it means taking a seat, taking a breath, whatever. Doing the meditation. Thank you, Bob Stein. Talking about meditation. Meditation is a medication to cure the illusion of separation. I've been singing that a lot lately. I love that. So, yeah, meditation for sure. So, but yeah, if you follow the heart or follow your conscience or meditate and go within, that's like your early warning system. And it may tell you then to go call somebody or go see somebody or get some help or whatever from the outside. But everything is always an inside job first. So, after that, what's next after following the master? Second is face the, well, the quote is devil, but we don't use that term in this talk. So I changed it to gremlin or fear. So they're kind of cute little characters. So hopefully nobody's fear in here is like a troll. You remember them trolls the bridges, the big ugly trolls? So hopefully your fear is not that bad. So, and I'm not talking about fear of snakes or heights or planes or anything like that. I'm talking about fear where it paralyzes you from moving on or doing something that you know you shouldn't do. False evidence appearing real. And it's the exact opposite of love. And it's also personal to each one of us. Everybody doesn't have the same kind of fears. I mean, I used to fear being surprisingly successful. I mean, which is kind of crazy or silly, but you know, if that's what it is, it's what it is. And it all starts at her age. So, you know, parents always have to be concerned about what it is there. Thought, word, and deed. Thought, word, and deed. And what they're demonstrating to their children, because they are the biggest copycatters in the world, aren't they? And fear is learned behavior. So whatever the young lady is learning now, that's going to turn into her world view. And we know fear kind of grips you and takes hold of you. Otherwise, why do we have these 21-day programs to try to change? And also, talk about the body. Depending on how steeped you are in it, if you continue it, it will hurt the body and cause that dis-ease or disorder. Because obviously the thoughts are not quite there, so it's kind of self-fulfilling. Remember, this is a wish-fulfilling planet. So we have to be careful about our thoughts. So faith can remove fear. And what I'd like to do now is read Marianne Williamson's poem or saying about fear. Our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate.
deepest fear is that we are so powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that most frightens us. We, of course, say, who am I to be brilliant? Who am I to be beautiful? Who am I to be fabulous? Who am I to be talented? Actually, who are you not to be? You are a child of God, and your playing small does not serve the world. You understand that? Playing small does not serve the world. There is nothing enlightened about shrinking so that other people won't feel insecure around you. We are all meant to shine as children do. We were born to make manifest the glory of God that is within us. It's not just in some, it's in everyone. And as we let our light shine, we unconsciously give other people permission to do the same. As we are liberated from our fear, our presence automatically liberates others. Isn't that wonderful?
Yes.
So, you think you have a fear, just face it and push through and go ahead and do it anyway. So once you get past the fear, what's next? Third is fight to the end. Now, this is a quote, but again, I don't necessarily like the word fight. For me, it just means work. Some action that you have to continue to do. Keep on keeping on. You can't, there's no wrong about it. That's the good news. Do the work to resolve whatever it is, the fear that you have. Is it the forgiveness work, the questioning work, you know, the self-inquiry, that's the self-reflection. So you can do the self-correction. You can't do it for anybody else. Now, I didn't look up the metaphysical meaning, but for me, it's almost like being reborn again. Remember that Christian phrase, unless you're born again? Yeah, that's what it reminds you of. And meditation, if there's one practice or action that everybody on the planet should be doing, it would be nice for everyone to be doing, it would be meditation. And her age or younger is the time to start. You're not afraid of the silence, are you? Remember, you may be alone in the room, but you're never alone. Just like there may be 40 or 50 bodies that I see in this room, we know the room is full. So the process is, don't give up. You must see it through. Persistence and consistency to the end. Otherwise, without trials and tribulations, how would you know there's any growth? If you don't want to do the work, then maybe just stay longer on the other side. Because when you come back here, there's no getting around it. The point is, you want to do it now in this body while it's still healthy and you know what to do, and then because we're living in interesting times, my understanding is it may be easier to get liberation so you don't have to come back again. It's a choice. Everything is about free will. Individual free will. Some days I think we have free will and other days I don't. But anyway, right now, we have free will. So, and lastly, fourth, finish the game. Because it is a game. Life is a game. That's my next title when I'm invited back. Game of life. Finish it. You can't get it wrong. Just keep on until. The nice thing is, hey, we have to say thank you, God, when we wake up and see another day. He even have another day, because you don't know when the illusion of death is going to capture you and you have to drop the body. So it's not this game over. It's just you got to go somewhere else and do something different. It's easier to get it done on this side. There's nothing to push against on the other side. That's what relatives here are for. Opportunity to be thankful and to say yes to whatever comes up for you. How do we finish the game? With spiritual practices, meditation and prayer and whatever else that it is that you want to do. How do we finish the game? With self-reflection, the inquiry of going inside and listening to that still small voice. And then putting together a game plan where you take baby steps to do the self-correction, even if it means doing the 21-day program, that you're ready and committed to do the work. Remember, I'm giving you people credit because you're new thought people. Not that we're better than anybody else, but we know what needs to be done. So how do we finish the game? Knowing that help and support is one thought away. Before you ask, it is already answered. How do we finish the game? Practice, 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 make perfect. Do over, as many times, and then click, click, click. So the epiphanies, the miracles can happen in a moment's notice, instant. That's for me. That's for me. How do we finish the game? In the beginning, I started with the BS, the belief systems. You got to kind of have to know which beliefs that maybe you need to change. And that's part of the growth of being here. What are your beliefs? And you may believe something one day, and then 2 hours from now, it may change, or next week. And just be open to that. And I think change is probably the biggest fear that most people have anyway. Because we get in our comfort zones and in our rut, and then, I don't know, the soul of the universe knows, we got to shake, rattle, and roll this person. They too comfortable. So, I talked about the prize. Who is the prize? Well, I answered the question almost in the first minute I began to talk. I kind of answered it with the children's message. Actually, God is the prize, therefore you are. Because you are divine. I mean, that's it in a nutshell. That's where we started from and began with. Knowing that there's no one else here. I mean, just God is here showing up to do the work and whatever else. So that's the beauty of this so-called journey of life. So the prize is you. Please picture yourself in this frame. All right. Thank you very much.
Reverend Dr. Cassandra Butler, thank you for reminding us of the beauty of who we are. Thank you for reminding us that we are the prize. And thank you for reminding us that we have to practice our inner work